Well, let's call this meeting to order. Your disease, Mo. Anyway.
It's a contagious.
Yeah, it is contagious. We will, does anyone want to make a public comment? I noticed there's one person from the public here. Public comment? No. Okay, great. Let's proceed then. First item is our finance action items.
All set to go?
Yeah, well, I think so. I may have to take the hard copy.
Do you have a hard copy?
Oh, I'll take the hard copy.
Here.
Of this, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Worked 2 minutes ago, but whatever. Here we go. Okay, now. Amendment one, if you want to proceed, Ms. Roberts.
Good morning, Dr. Randles and committee members. As I think we mentioned at the last meeting and talked about a little bit at last week's work session, this is a time of year where we, after the first 6 months, where we go back and bring to this body, then ultimately the board, an amendment to the budget. When the budget is finalized and approved by you in June, there are a lot of things we still don't know about, you know, what our federal fund allocation is, the state funding, and obviously as school goes on, things turn out differently than when we had anticipated. So amendment one for both the general operating fund and the special revenue fund we're bringing to this committee this morning and asking for your approval to move it to the board for their approval on the March 7th board meeting. That's included in your packet. You'll see a lot of what transpired this year was moving dollars around into the appropriate functions, if you will. On the general fund, the ultimate impact on the fund balance, and we had adopted back in June, or you had adopted back in June, for the year at least, a deficit of about $546,000 use of fund balance. This reduces that. We pick up about $179,000, so it reduces the deficit down to $367,000 approximately, if all goes according to plan over the next few months here as we finish out fiscal year 2016. So the detail behind that, both revenue expenditure side, you'll see a lot of it is just moving dollars between, as I mentioned earlier, between categories as we got more information. Some of the bigger adjustments relate to our restricted funds, both federal and state, as we got more information as to what those allocations would be to change those budgets, both on the revenue side, and as we've talked about before, on restricted dollars, we only spend what we get. So as we have revenue increases on the title programs, we had some dollars in the GRSP adult ed section 41, et cetera. As we see increases in the revenue on those side, we have similar increases on the expenditure side to spend those funds. So when things are all said and done, as I mentioned, we actually come out a little bit better than what we had adopted back in June. The special revenue fund, just the opposite. We actually add a little bit to the deficit there. We have significant fund balance and appropriate fund balance. In the special revenue fund, again, our major programs there are the special education center programs, if you will. So some minor adjustments there to get down to where we think we're going to come out at year end. So that's kind of overall summary of what went on with Amendment 1 in both the general fund and the special revenue fund. And obviously, I appreciate it. It's a lot of work to get to these amendments, and Rhonda and the rest of the business office spent a lot of time trying to nail this down, so I appreciate that effort. And if you have any detailed questions on this, yes, Rhonda is here to who gets into more of the details than I have, but that's overall summary. So you may recall last year we had a big use of fund balance. Just to remind you, on the general fund, that was primarily because of the Synergy software, which had not been in the original budget. So unlike last year, there were no big movements one way or the other once everything came together, and it was just primarily getting the functions and the expense revenue categories where they needed to be. Yes, Dr. Flores.
What did we attribute the decrease in funding for special ed center programs?
Well, you can see there's several factors that went into it. If you look at the detail, you'll see that we had some revenue decreases in the tuition revenue. Again, that's based on that's tuition that other districts pay us for their students, and as we got counts as to what those students would be, we adjusted the revenue to reflect what we think we're going to get based on the tuition counts that came through on the fall count. And then we also had some, you know, we adopt the budget in both the general and special revenue. You know, we have open positions we're still looking for. We don't have our staffing finalized, and so we picked up some, increase our expenditure side primarily in the salaries and benefit portion as we got additional positions hired and those kinds of things that again were estimated as of our budget year. When we do our budget, as we look at the people cost, you know, by and large we do it on a budget basis is assign a approximate, I'm going to call it average cost of a person. Then for amendment one, we actually go back and see, obviously, more tenured people cost us more than newer folks. And so we more precisely measure what those, based on the people we actually have in place, what those people costs are going to be. So in this case, in special revenue, as I mentioned, we filled some positions and we looked at the actual people in place. It costs us a little more money. So that's the main factors in that small decrease in fund balance.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, comments? I do believe we need two motions, right?
Yeah, we need one specific to the general fund and to the special revenue. So, yeah.
Support.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Same sign. And we need the second special revenue. Motion to approve the special revenue fund.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Same sign. They both pass. Right.
Yeah, one donation for this committee to act on from Brewery Vivant, who's been a partner with our Congress Elementary School for a number of years. I think we had at least brought to the board back in, I think it was back in December, Brewery Vivant were celebrating their fifth anniversary. And and they had a big, on a Sunday, my daughter and I went down there. They had a big celebration, birthday party, if you will, or anniversary party. And as part of that celebration of 5 years there, they were raising money for our Congress. And so about 60 Chromebooks with a value they're going to give to our Congress Elementary, value of about $20,000. And our policy requires to bring those more than $2,500 to this committee for their approval. So that's the donation this month.
Great. You think so?
Yes.
Very nice. School is doing well.
Motion to approve the donation.
Make that motion.
Support.
All in favor?
Aye.
Same sign. We Recommendations approved. Thank you.
And then the purchasing agenda, a number of things this month on that. Several items related to some technology purchases, some related to our bond and continued construction, not only bond construction, but warm, safe, and dry, and then a few other service categories. So if anyone has any questions on any of the items in the purchase agenda, I'd be more than happy to answer them or have someone else who are behind me here.
Anyone have any?
I didn't.
Well, I have to go back to the support materials, Maynard Thompson Educational Services, only to remain consistent with my other concern about this. There was lack of information in my original dissent vote regarding this consultantship, and I guess in retrospect, looking at that, I think my concern is very valid that we ought to have more information provided in situations where consultants are presented, and I think that having raised an issue as I did back then, that there'd be some level of correction going forward and providing some accommodation for it. More information, mm-hmm. which then leads to greater transparency. So just for the record and for the sake of the organization, and the good of the will of the people and so forth, mm-hmm. If we could consider that in the future, it would certainly make my responsibility a little more easier to justify, I guess. Thank you.
So noted on my end.
Other concerns, questions? Well, to approve the purchasing agenda?
So moved.
Court. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Agenda passes. First of the agenda passes. Next item.
January financial statements, and I guess as was apparent from the budget amendment, you know, we're tracking pretty close to an overall basis through January to where we had expected to track in terms of both revenue by and large and expenses. Continue to one thing I changed on the dashboard, the first sheet there, to be consistent with the January work session when I talked about the new early warning and the different fund balance calculations, you may recall, in the state under early warning. At this point, again, they're still working on clarification. They've taken, for early warning purposes, a fund balance calculation which uses revenue as a denominator instead of expenses. So on the bottom of that dashboard, and they also use unassigned fund balance, you'll see I've changed that measure to be consistent with that. And again, I hope to bring to this body at some point a suggested policy, board policy on fund balance. I'm just trying to wait to get more clarification from the state, because they were changing metrics and trying to get clarification out of the Treasury as to what some of these factors are, and that's still in process as of now. So under that new measure, again, on an interim basis, we're still well above the 5% measure, but that's just to be consistent so we know where we stand from that perspective. So things are, as I said, tracking well from January or through January, so I'll certainly answer any questions that you may have regarding that.
Any questions, comments? Okay. We're ready to move on.
Good. And that, then on the governor's budget, which was released a couple of weeks ago, I've provided in the packet the House Fiscal Agency's analysis of that. I have found this summary to be, I think, the best. It kind of weeds through all the detail in the legislation and kind of lays out some of the major major provisions. I mentioned last, the board, the work session last week, you know, the governor is recommending for us, which would be $120 per pupil increase in the foundation allowance, right around $2 million based on our current enrollment. You can see item two on that first page, continue to fund the MIPSER's unfunded liability. It's up to almost, or will be, if under the governor's proposal, almost $1 billion a year to fund that. And then a couple of other major provisions, the count, which had been 10% of the prior February count and 90% of the fall count, the governor is proposing a 50-50, which generally would benefit those districts losing students. But actually, an analysis has been done already for Kent County, and it's all over the place. We would, again, based on current counts, we would have come out about $140,000 better this year under the 50-50. Byron Center, who was one of the few districts that have been growing the last couple of years, would lose about $340,000. And so it's will impact districts in our ISD at least differently, depending on where things stand, if it passes. And then a couple other changes that potentially would have some impact on us is back on page three, the pupil membership definition. This relates to our shared time. They have a really to be consistent. So a shared time person could not count for more than one third FTE. I talked briefly with both our shared time director as well as OIS, and we have maybe 20, 25 students that may be above that one third. So if that goes through, it may impact us negatively, but not significant. The more positive is a pupil transfer process, section 25E, again, at the bottom of page three of that analysis, where it's a pretty complicated computation when students transfer between districts, between count dates. The governor is recommending that that be repealed, that section, which means the folks would stay with their home district in the fall count date, which would benefit us. We have somewhere between 25 and 50 on average every year that we lose part of an FTE, so that would be a benefit to us. I think I mentioned last month to this group that, based on a conference we had gone to in January, we didn't expect a lot from the state in terms of funding. So this is a positive. I will caution you, the governor's proposal has a lot of one-time funding dollars, about $175 million out of the general fund that doesn't carry forward into, not necessarily carry forward to the 17-18 year. So, you know, we have to be cognizant of that as we do our budgeting, not only for the immediate next year, but as we look at a couple of years down the road. And the uncertainty that remains with how that funding might look. But as of right now, it looks good for 16-17. Again, we're a long way from the budget being finalized. The House and the Senate will chime in. As I mentioned earlier, there is a revenue estimating conference mid-May, and no final budget decisions. Neither will a final budget be passed until after that conference. If that conference shows things coming up short on the revenue side, you know, some of these things will obviously change. So that's where things stand now. And that's just a summary for you to look at as to what the governor thinks about things.
Questions, comments? I have a couple. The 15 other program eliminations, 31C, gang prevention grants. Much does that impact us, or is that just $1 million overall?
Where you're looking, Dr.
Well, page three of that packet, number 15.
I don't specifically to us, but when they talk about a million that's a million statewide.
Statewide, so that's not significant, those are all a reduction in that particular situation.
Yeah. How much? I don't know. Do we get any dollars from that? We don't get any dollars from that, so it'd be no impact on us.
And then the special ed, is that a significant increase? Are they, you know, is that going to potentially be anything?
Yeah, I mean, again, we have a pretty significant special ed program. So anytime there's any impact on statewide special ed funding, it will impact us. And in this case, the governor wants to increase by $54.5 million. So we will get our fair share. One thing which brings up another issue, Dr. Randall's, this issue with itinerant employees and this additional funding we've been getting for a number of years when there's appropriated dollars that are left over at the end of the year. Those dollars have gone back to us and a few other counties that have a similar model, and it's a little bit complicated as we got into it. Last couple of months, we had a group at the ISD level to look at that again, just because there was a sunset to that provision. I believe it was last year or 2 years ago. That got changed. The year we're in now currently limits those funds to a maximum of $2 million. Over the last 15 years, let's say, we've gotten anywhere from $300,000 to a few years ago, I think it was my first year here, was $4.5 or $5 million. It was that big year that the legislators took notice and said, geez, it's a lot of money. And so we were concerned.
You're educating a lot of kids. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, I mean, the fact remains, as you know, our special ed program is still underfunded in terms of what it costs us in spite of that. There was concern that $2 million max would go away. The governor has preserved that in his budget, and the wording is such that there's no sunset to that. So, you know, our lobbyists have been very active in trying to maintain it. And so the governor at this point is going to maintain it. But again, we'll see.
Right. So it could be good or it could be...
It's like everything else, yeah.
And then is mid-May a little late for the revenue sharing?
Well, it is for us and every other governmental organization that pretty much has to have budgets approved by June 30th.
Wait,
school districts, cities.
Previously, earlier. Right?
That's why, in spite of everything we do to try to move this earlier, we don't know the revenue, but so the conference is in May. Ultimately, you know, the budget doesn't get finalized and approved till January or June 1st at the earliest. And so we're scrambling to try to plug those numbers in to see now if we have to make adjustments on the expense side, which we've been working on all along. That's why it's been problematic in trying to get to this body, why we've had to have special finance committee meetings in early June in order to get it to the board by June 30th. So, yeah, they don't make it easy for us in terms of those kinds of things. But, you know, we will have more information as the House and Senate over the next several weeks come out with their versions of it that will build into our preliminary budgets, you know, work to finalize our expense side as we always do. I think we have building budget meetings scheduled beginning next week, and then you know, then just wait for that final budget to see if it changes significantly. You know, we should have a good sense a week after the May revenue estimating conference where things may come out. So we work as quickly and as diligently we can to get stuff done in time. But ultimately, as you know, we like to bring to you and to the board is a budget that has, you know, the best information we have at that point in time. And so we need to wait till the final budget is adopted by the legislature.
Okay. Anything else? We can move on.
Item three under that is the Dyer's Eye Foundation. They have granted a $50,000 amount for us to use primarily for our museum high school, and it's really a planning, you could talk about it. Okay.
It's for planning. There are two pieces to it. One is for working with the community on how the community would use the facility or be able to use the facility and what they'd like to see. And the other piece is as we select the architect for that project, for an analysis of what we can do for energy and environmental design on the building. It's one of the last, if not the last, WPA constructed buildings in the country. While it's not historic, it does have significant historical features, and we really had not intended doing much of anything to the exterior. Our work would be on the interior. But we do need to, this will help us a lot to determine what we can do energy-wise with the building, where we can do it, what we can do without impacting negatively the architecture that's there. So it's a really nice benefit to us to have that initial planning funded, both for our work and the community involved.
As you may recall, you know, a big, or it's intention planned, the big chunk of the museum school, both the downtown Van Andel Center and then high school, to be funded with donations. It's just part of it. This is below the threshold where we need your approval. We brought it to you just for your information, so you're aware of, and we will continue to do that with these grant dollars, whether they're above or below, to maintain that transparency with all our bond funding and everything else going to the new construction. So we appreciate that, certainly from Dyer's Eyes Foundation. That's the first piece of donation money for the museum schools.
Yeah, I agree. It's great. Mm-hmm. Have community input and energy efficiency helps us in the long run. Great. Thank you. Next list.
Safe and dry, Ken. Any comments?
Projects for this summer, the Ottawa pool dehumidification system. The equipment's been ordered. We expect to take over the pool area shortly after spring break, after the swim season is completed, and we can start that work. The two other that have been approved, the data center air conditioning, that will take place this summer. There's a window where you can put the data center down and do that equipment change. And the GRPS University parking expansion will probably be made when the weather breaks. There's two others that were on our list. One are the heating controls for this campus. We have to bid that yet, and we'll bring that to this committee when we get the bids. And then the GRPS University air conditioning project, we've actually decided to defer that for a while, partly to determine, make sure our finances are in order as we go into the final year of warm, safe, dry projects. But also we're balancing our final list and priorities of bond projects, and we want to make sure we don't give any specific buildings unnecessary funds from both funding sources when we could do what we want. So depending on where university falls in the bond priority, this may get deferred into the bond project, or if that's off a number of years, it may go ahead. But we'll bring that back once those decisions are made. I have not brought the updated warm, safe, and dry recommended list as we normally do in January, just because we want that bond list finalized, and we hope to get that completed by the end of the month, and then balance the two lists accordingly with projects. So that will be coming sometime in the next few months, and we'll recommend our last year's group of projects. And I'll just expand into bond while I've got the floor. We have started both the Koval project and the fourth floor at the Van Andel Museum project for the 6th, 7th, and 8th grades for next year. Those are underway. Both have a August 1st completion date.
Great. Questions, comments? The Ottawa Hills pool, the community uses that a lot in the summer for swimming lessons. Will that be available then, or what will happen?
The pool will be shut down.
And
athletics, all scheduling will have to be through the union and city
pools. Okay, yeah. Well, maybe the local kids around city. Had city had swimming for community students?
Department is in there.
Yeah.
I'm not sure exactly what the community use is. I know the rec department does use city.
City, okay.
Our athletic department has been using it for middle school, whether it's lessons or whatever they
sure.
do on a level of competition.
Mm-hmm, okay. Good. Next items. Round of policy. We have one policy in here. 80s, I believe it is, on our packet. Yeah. Oh, first we have a sustainability update. Looks like page 81 of the packet.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I just have a few initiatives or items to update you all on. The first is Frost at Sierra Frost. We've started composting there. As you know, we've started composting at a few of our schools and adding an additional school about once a semester as we have interest from a school and we have the budget allows for that. And so that was something that had been requested at CA Frost for probably since I've arrived here. They've been asking mm-hmm. for composting, and so we were able to start making that happen in January of this year. And at Frost we're taking a slightly different approach than we have at the other schools, in that we're partnering with a local nonprofit organization to do some of our, I guess, quote unquote, marketing or education of the students. Mm. And so they've really come in, and that's been a partnership that Frost has secured and explored on their own. I think their PTA has done that. And so they've been really involved in the school and talking about what the signs look like so that we're communicating with the students and making it easy for them to understand how to sort their waste. They have got classroom lessons tied in as well about why we're composting, where our waste goes, what goes in the landfill, things like that. And it's been really successful so far. In initial numbers, they were diverting 91% of their waste from the landfill. So that was extraordinarily high, actually, for one of our programs to be recycling and composting that high volume. So we're going to keep watching that closely and look if we can scale back their trash service accordingly to mm-hmm. save money that way as well, since they're doing so well in reducing their landfill waste so much.
Good lessons.
Yeah, they're doing great over there. Yeah, it's fantastic. We've also, I don't think I've updated you on our green cleaning program in a while. Over the fall, we made the switch. We've made the switch to all green cleaners and reduced our chemical usage in the district vastly. From there were over 50 chemicals, we're down to 6 now. But we've also made a switch from using these disposable wipe balls, which are kind of like what you would look like a Clorox wipe or something like that, disposable wipe. That our custodial staff were using and whomever else would get into the custodians' closets and grab a pack and things like that. We've switched to using reusable microfiber cloths. And so every custodian in the district has 3 sets of cloths. They all have they're color-coded with different purposes, and they get washed every night and put in a bucket of solution and dried and things like that. And so by just making that switch, over the course of the next year, from using the reusable instead of the disposable, we're expecting to save around $104,000 a year going forward doing that. So not to mention all the disposable cloths that aren't being thrown in landfill and the packaging and things like that. And they were also clogging up our toilets because they would get flushed down the toilet. And so they were causing a lot of maintenance issues for our staff as well. So hopefully we'll be tracking the number of maintenance requests related to that, and we'll see that drop down as well. So at the very minimum, we should see around $100,000 a year going forward in savings for the district from that program. And then the last initiative I wanted to update you on was the WegoWise energy savings or not energy things, but energy data tracking software that we put in place last June. And I just wanted to update you that we've, you know, all of our buildings are in that program now. We're checking that every month. And one of the ways it's benefiting us, or that we've found it to be helpful, is that we can identify spikes, so we can project what we expect given the weather patterns and historical usage at that building, and, you know, consistent use of a building. We can project what we think the energy usage will be for a month out, and if it varies from that significantly, we can identify that it's spiking, basically, or we have some spikes that we need to tend to. So, for example, we have at Union, we've identified Union is using more energy than we would expect based on how it has historically used energy and the amount it's used. And so it doesn't tell us, you know, exactly what's going on there, of course, but it gives us kind of that red warning, or like a red flag, that we need to go start investigating so we can look into that. And that's something we just didn't have previously, that kind of immediate data to direct our efforts and to resolve those issues. So,
great.
Good. Yeah. Do we have? Tell us about the interplay between recycling generally and trash. If you look at those contracts, how are the waste haulers paid? Do they have incentives to recycle?
Right. So we have our recycling and our trash is currently handled by the same hauler. It's all part of one contract. It's just different tipping fees or, you know, hauling fees, basically. So if we have a 2-yard dumpster that, you know, is trash that is picked up 3 times a week, it's X. If we have a 3-yard dumpster of recycling that is picked up once a week, it's Y, things like that. So it's part of the same contract and the same fee schedule that we have set up. We have looked at reducing the size or the frequency of pickups of our trash dumpsters, where we have started composting or seeing increased recycling consistently. We need to make sure that it's consistently, we're not undersizing our trash, and then we don't have enough space or capacity, say if we, you know, have big events or things like that. But where it's consistently decreased, we are able to reduce the size or frequency of pickups there to save money. In terms of in-classroom recycling across the district, that varies depending on school and, you know, the facilities that they have. We have had some teachers request in about the past month that have become really interested in recycling and have asked for, like, the plastic bins or things like that for their classroom. And we do not have a supply of those bins right now, nor do we have a budget identified for where we should purchase from them. My suggestion to them in all these cases is, you know, you can do what I do under my desk, is get a small cardboard box. I've laid out clearly what can go in those bins so that they know, and they have that information that's been sent out a couple times, and they can start using that. When there's interest and they're actually, you know, doing that consistently, then I can see putting the resources to investing in those bins and, you know, making it a little more polished, but largely. Sure, I mean, we can put recycling bins in every classroom. It just doesn't necessarily mean that they'll recycle, but we can make those facilities available, and, I mean, I can run the numbers to see what that would cost.
At this point, you've probably got citizens who understand that. It's not hard to find a recycling bin, and I, you know, every single time I'm bored, I do this little punch around the building to find a recycling bin. There's none in this room. It's hard to recycle things as a board member. There's four, and everyone knows the little arrow symbols on them. So I'd like to see a proposal to some scale saying, let's have a cardboard box and let's see what it feels like. Five. I'd really like to see some action.
Okay.
Two things. I know that the city has a lot of the blue plastic bins that we used to use for recycling, and they have said that they will give those to us free previously, that that would be something that we, you know, they're in storage, we'd have to wash them up and take them. And so that's, you know, you can reach out to the city and see about that. The other issue is that we are doing some composting through, I mean, recycling through the city. How is that? So I know, you know, so you have some places that are doing recycling. Is it all single stream? I think that sort of helps.
Right, so we do, yeah. At every school, we do have recycling dumpster available. Mm-hmm. And then in most of our schools, the city has given us two of the 96-gallon residential size recycling containers that they pick up every other week, similar to the residential. The problem with the 96-gallon carts is that they've moved around a little bit, so some schools have now acquired four, some do not know where theirs are anymore, so we've done kind of an inventory to see where they are and matching up with the city to see if where we have them is where they think they are and things like that. The 96-gallon containers, one of the barriers to using those is that there needs to be a champion in the building to roll them out to the street and put them out just like you would at your house. And so if there's not a passionate teacher or an e-club or something like that, it just doesn't get done. That's not to say recycling doesn't happen.
Why is that not a custodial job? I mean, that's part of... So I don't understand why that has to be a champion. That's a barrier to recycling, and it's not very conducive,
sure.
Nor is it part of then our big recycling.
That is something we can talk about with our, you know, maintenance supervisors. I'm not the custodial supervisor, so for me to add on, you know, to their task list, you know, I have to consult with others to do that. That's possible. We don't have the 96-gallon carts, or even where we do, I advocate that we just use the dumpster behind the school, because the only things that the 96-gallon carts can take that the dumpsters cannot take are glass and plastic bags. And we don't have a significant volume of glass or plastic bags at our schools.
Cool, sure.
And so we can use the dumpster that we're paying for,
right.
We should. Where the 96-gallon is, there's a capacity issue with that, too. I mean, they fill up very quickly, too, for a school is,
plus,
you know, every 2 weeks.
Plus snowy streets and our limiting factors.
Well, it also is essentially cost out.
Mm-hmm.
The rough savings per dumpster of a 96-gallon versus filling into a dumpster. And if you're saving, say, $10, and it costs us $2 to have the stove and roll it out, or say, $10, and it costs $50 to have the stove and roll it out.
Sure.
Where if this $100,000 we can save here on our recycling. I mean, I don't know what the scale of the numbers are, so wouldn't it come back?
Well, and it doesn't sound like a lot of people are aware of the recycling dumpsters available for each building or
right,
what that capacity is.
Where, because there's been a lot of horse trading between schools, where if some school doesn't use them, they've been offering to
appear. I mean behind the buildings, then the trash
that
and the recycling.
Where the custodians do load that. That is their responsibility to load the large dumpster that sits next to the trash dumpster.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and if it costs essentially $10 to bring a functional, if it costs an hour to spend this time to mess around with the dumpster that saves us $3, then it doesn't make sense to use the city services. I mean,
right.
Or displacing significant cost, it does. But more importantly, if we
can
get
an analysis.
Recycling, we have less garbage. Mm-hmm. We're not going to create garbage by having recycling in the classroom.
True.
So that clearly ought to set us on.
And this is something we will pursue and get back to you on. And we had talked about how do we bring all buildings up to some minimum reasonable standard of recycling so it's not so sporadic building to building. And Chris and I have been talking about how to propose that and get that.
So in two months we can have sort of an analysis and report. Would that be reasonable to have sure, in terms of, okay.
Question on, who's our current vendor for trash pickup?
Believe it's Allied Waste.
Allied, and then how often is that bid out? Just curious.
Every 3 to 5 years, I want to say. I want to say it's every 3 to 5, somewhere in that range. The contract was just rebid and signed in summer of 2014, right before I started.
Okay.
It is done through purchasing as a group.
Okay.
Let's see. Oh, one last thing about U of M has just been having a norovirus outbreak, and are our chemicals adequate to be viricide?
Yes.
So
yes. Absolutely.
Have that out before we.
Yes. That was part of our criteria when we were switching, to make sure that, you know, they were both, you know, safe, cost effective, and they were effective at treating everything. And yes, they were.
Anything else?
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
The good work.
Indeed.
Thank you.
Impressed.
Right now, we are onto our last item, it looks like, board investment policy.
Yeah, really in connection with the bond issue you know, as we get those bond funds in place, we obviously don't use it all at once, so they're invested. But really in connection with that, I took a look at our investment policy, the board policy, which is 3,000, which is in your, or 3,300, which is in your packet there, and work with our financial advisor just to make sure that this was up to date. And there were some changes you know, he and I together, working together, are proposing, you know, understand with the low interest rate environment, a couple of things. First of all, you may or may not be aware, but we're limited. All governmental organizations are limited as to what they can invest in. And one thing we can invest in is equities, all right? And so we're already limited from that perspective. Given the low interest rate environment, doesn't give us a lot of opportunities to really improve our yield. But nonetheless, and the policy as written, and I've left it the same, really exempts the investment of bond funds, simply because bond indentures, which are the rules governing our bonds, essentially have guidance as to what those can be invested in. I've talked with our bond counsel, first of all, to make sure that the bond indenture is consistent with state law. State law also applies to bond investments. Sometimes you'll see in bond indentures specific investment vehicles enumerated, which may limit that. So I've asked her to make sure that we have the broadest, according to law, broadest ability to invest those bond funds. But it just made sense, given that we look at the whole investment of fund policy. So you can see, hopefully you have the changes that we're recommending that are in a different color. You know, we used to, in the old days, had an investment officer that really, with the cutbacks, is we don't have that person anymore, who was Dave Bardoff for a number of years. So I'm just asking that we designate the CFO as the chief investment officer at this point. And then there's some other changes just to update. And this is really, I'm going to call it best practices. That's why I work with the financial advisor. They deal with a lot of different organizations, and these are their suggestions too, to get this policy up to best practices within investment policy. So I bring it to you for your review, I guess, any comments or questions, and then it'll go through the normal process at the board level of first reading, et cetera, type stuff. But any questions on that?
Any questions, comments?
So
I think then bring this to the board whenever you
March 7th we'll do that then. So just one other thing, Dr. Randall, we talked about the bond here, just to give you an update. We still are scheduled, we lots been going on last, since we last met as a finance committee. Last Tuesday, Teresa and I had a conference call with Moody's to rate the bonds. We should hear on that, I believe, end of this week. We still are on schedule to actually price the bonds next Tuesday, March 1st. That's when we go to market, essentially, and determine what the cost is, interest cost, if you will. So that'll happen on Tuesday. There's several calls with the underwriters at that point in time. That bond authorizing resolution you passed, I think in January, you recall, gives Teresa and I the authority to, during that process, to make final decisions, and there's parameters certainly in there. And the market has still been favorable to fixed income, to our bonds, so we are still looking good in terms of that. And if things remain the same, we still will go ahead. Again, the other uncertainty we talked about is refunding that advance refund in the 2007 issue, about $53 million. Again, as of end of last week, the market still looks good, favorable to refund those and save our taxpayers some dollars over that refunding issue. So it's also easier to sell to institutional investors, the larger the issue. So when we refund together with new money, it takes that issue up to $130 million. And so it's all looking very positive from a market perspective. We still have a week to worry about it. Then on Wednesday, March 2nd, we actually signed the bond purchase agreement with the underwriters, and then ultimately we're scheduled to actually close on it, get our money in the bank around March 16th. So that's how things are timing out at this point in time. And as Ken mentioned, we're always spending money, so we're still on track to get those dollars in place, and we'll be all set. So. Okay.
Any updates about the financial software? You had talked about getting that at
the
financial, updating your financial software in the business department.
Yeah, there is. Actually, we met, Teresa, Ron, and I met on Friday to talk about a number of things, and including, you know, some preliminary multi-year projections. You may recall we're working to, on a regular basis, to present a more of a rolling long-term budget in addition to the annual budget. I would anticipate bringing something to this committee next month for approval to upgrade. It's the point now we've got to it. It's, you know, we're 10 years behind the expiration date, really, of the software. We're just, you know, sewing it together, piecing it together. Still a lot of manual processes are in place to make use of it, which, as you know, results in additional human error when you get that process. So one of the things that we can do, when we first looked at that, there, even though the big cost of it is in the actual application software, which we only can fund out of general operating dollars, there were some server upgrades that were needed, maybe around $100,000, that we should be able to fund with the bond money now. So it's the spend from the general fund may be in the area of $400,000, but I'll have that information for you. Hope to bring it in the next board meeting for your approval to move forward and get that throughout. It'll be really the fiscal year 17 process. So after July 1st, we'll begin the process of converting that and have to turn it on live, if you will. It'd be July 1st of 2017. But a 12-month time frame, because, I mean, it's technically an upgrade because it's the same software, but it's so different than what we have. So it's almost like installing a new system. So a 12-month implementation process allows us to plan it well and make sure everything is done appropriately. So when we turn it on, hopefully there's minimal problems we have to fix at that point. So yeah, but thanks for reminding me of that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then just a reminder to us that, we were talking about vision and goal setting and things like that, and that sort of, as we do this budgeting, time to start thinking about it. talk about it in November, but goals for the superintendent, goals for the district as a whole. I think as we're building the budget, this is the time to be thinking about it. All right, I think meeting adjourned.